She made it up. She's sucking on a robot dick.
Very unprofessional. Keep us waiting.
It's a vape. I swear to God, I'm not doing anything else. Gino, thank you for sending me that crown. You know I'm your favorite. The rest of you just got a fake one, but Gino, send me the real one.
You got
one.
A real one.
That's right.
Queen of living cruddy.
That's right. I mean, I'm not saying you bought me a nice crown.
If you could lay on the floor and then hold the camera over you.
I only do that for my OnlyFans. Thank you very much. You got to pay for that service and pay big.
Can you guys hear my theme music?
I want Joe to sing it.
He only knows one song.
Yeah, that's true, and he doesn't know it well.
Interview over, you bitch.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
What did he say? Did he get his claws out, kitty kitty?
Good evening, weirdos, and welcome to Livin' Cruddy with Cruddy Joe, the Ireland edition. I am your host, Cruddy Darby O'Gill, and I'm here with the House of Pain gang. We have handsome Jimmy Shenanigans and the full shillelagh, Gino Roy and McGillicuddy. Our guest tonight is a therapist, a mom, a COVID zombies enthusiast, and the watch party attendee with the farthest commute. It's Ms. Lisa Allan Monaghan. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
I'm trying to recall the first time you stumbled upon our watch party night, and you probably know better than I do, but I knew at the time that you were someone that lived overseas, Northern Ireland, and I thought it was very strange that somebody would stay up that late. How did you stumble across it? How did you figure out what was going on?
I think I got a request to like it, and then I would sneak in, and then one of you would spook me by going, "Hello, Lisa," and I dart off of it real quick. So now I love it when people come in and I see they come in, because I always go, "Hello," to see if I can spook them. That's how I came in. And then I came in, and I mean, I remember you, Gino, from when we were younger, mostly through an acquaintance that we had. And Gino was the decent one of the group, so that tells you.
When we first were friends on Facebook, mm-hmm. I thought you were somebody completely different, somebody that I knew from Belvedere Homes. You're connected to like the Believers guys, right?
Yeah. I've dated a lot of musicians.
Well, I knew that they had a lot of friends that were from that area, and that's who I thought you were. Then when we discussed it later for our other mutual friend, I remember very specifically dropping him off over at your house. And this is when we were kids. I mean, we were like high school age. And then you were a couple years behind me in that regard. Drexel Road area, right?
Drexel Road. I remember it well. Jimmy, you remember hanging out at Woodcrest?
Totally.
Days, am I right?
Yeah, it was wicked great.
It was wicked cool.
Wicked cool.
Including Jenny and Joe from the conversation.
They're always oblivious to this stuff. Now, that neighborhood, I recall, had a very much, at the time, like a dazed and confused vibe. If you see that movie, that was kind of how it played out. A lot of people had like Camaros and Chevelles. And I mean, this was that time. And Twin Lakes was more like...
I mean, I was really, really, really young. So, yeah.
Read about it in the history books.
Yeah. I mean, I heard about these alleged 80s, but I was, you know, I was still just a baby at that time.
That school was very much like a Hollywood high school. It was right next to the beach. There was a lot of people that would like literally show up at the school with surfboards. Mm-hmm. People dressed for the beach, and that's where they would go when they skipped school.
I put my bathing suit on underneath my clothes, and my mom would always say, "I know you're not going to school today." I'd come back with a really great tan.
Twin Lakes was the Burt Reynolds school. That's where Burt Reynolds graduated. I was banished to the south side of the main entrance, but I remember all the like rough rednecks would be on the north side. They were the ones that you would drive by with your rock and roll blasting as loud as possible and flip them off, and then you go park on the other side of the school.
They wore the watermelon caps. Remember the watermelon caps?
I remember those. Yeah, I have one of those still, even though I was not a watermelon cap wearer. I thought that was ridiculous.
They don't have this where you guys went to school on the main streets of, what was it, Detroit, Alabama?
That's right. Jimmy's from Alabama.
With a banjo on his knee.
Jimmy went to high school in Rochester, New York, right?
Yeah.
It's a terrible place.
And Joe, did you go to school in Detroit or did you move before that?
I went to school in Detroit.
Okay, so you're from Detroit Rock City.
Mine might be the opposite of Palm Beach, yeah.
But isn't Twin Lakes where the butter comes from?
Yes.
It's Lando Lake.
Lando Lake. No.
Potato, potato.
Circling around to our mutual acquaintance, I had dropped that person off at your house, so that was my earliest knowledge of you. I would have never guessed that all these years later that somehow I would know who that person was.
Didn't you play at Foundations in Palm Beach?
No, Stallions.
Foundations was what it became, but I played there when it was originally the Pit, and then it became 21 North, and finally Foundation. By the time it became Foundation, they didn't want us to play there anymore, but we snuck in a couple times. So we played a shitload at Respectables. And
I want you to know, Gino, that I'm actually here to interview you finally.
Well, they got the Gigi Allen story out of me last week, so there's not much more to tell.
I saw Gigi Allen at CBGB's.
Here we go.
I was only four.
Because I let four-year-olds into CBGBs.
And I can't believe you don't remember Mark Renser and John Rinaldi.
People had like code names back in the day.
Yeah.
I mean, there's people that maybe I knew them, but they went under their punk rock name. And I would never known their real names. Who the hell knows? When I started playing music back then, there was literally one other punk band entity that existed before we did.
And did you play at Churchill's too?
Oh, yeah. I played at Churchill's many times, which still exists today.
See, you didn't even need to get a vaccine.
Probably not. Now, my ex-wife, if I ever brought up Churchill's, some guy jumped off a table and shattered her leg, and she still holds that against me.
I totally blame you as well. Yeah.
Leg-breaking frenzy.
Well, I have one other question before I let Joe go off with his scheduled questions, but you ended up in Northern Ireland, of all places. I've never heard the story of how you wound up there.
Well, that's one of my questions, you bastard. Yeah, the question was specifically, what was the impetus behind your defection to Ireland, and how do you live with yourself having known you betrayed your country?
Very well. I live with myself very well. I get the socialist cheese. And the trade-off is they watch everything I do. Cameras everywhere. In 2008, my then husband and I had bought a house in Lake Worth in what was supposed to be up and coming. It was up and coming to be more of a ghetto, actually. We bought during the boom. We were plugging along, and then we got hit by four hurricanes in one summer. So that did some damage to the house. And then we had some plumbing issues in 2007, and somebody came in and said, you don't have any foundation. So that was like $25,000 or something to jack the house up and all this other stuff. This is a series of events, and he was working acoustical engineer, so they did like acoustical ceilings and walls, and he had a great job, paid great money, and then the crash hit, the economy went to crap, and he was only working 2 days a week, and then his dad had a heart attack in Northern Ireland. He was like, we need to leave, we need to go back. So we moved here, and the kids were young, and I had always said, because he had said he, when we got married, that he may one day want to live here again, and I said, if the kids were young, that I would be okay with that. And that's what we did. So we moved here when the kids were young, and they now have Irish accents.
That's crazy. But you don't have any Irish accent, or do you just put on, you put on for our show that you sound American?
I put on for the show. Usually I'm just, you know, she all day long. Yeah.
I was going to say, can you feign an Irish girl?
I can't. It's a hate crime. I can't do it. It's really bad. People get so mad at me. If I run into people from Southern Ireland, especially from Dublin, I will pick it up and it sounds like I'm actually mocking them. And it's awful.
No one from Dublin watches this. Let's hear it.
No. They'll bring me up on charges.
When I was in Ireland, we had a guy that was basically our driver. We had asked him about going to Northern Ireland, and he immediately like got really angry in the face and was like, I won't fucking take you there. Fuck that place. It's boring. It's like political or whatever. That was our perception of the whole deal. Then, of course, like a year later, Game of Thrones comes out, and it turns like all the cool shit in the entire series of that was filmed up that way. So I'm like, man, that guy, his political views or whatever he was disagreeing totally robbed us of the opportunity to see all that stuff.
There's a reason they kept Northern Ireland. It's beautiful. It's stunning. I mean, that stuff with the Troubles, that is such a small group of people. It's right. Not a huge group, but it makes the news and then everybody thinks that's what it is. I suppose if I wanted to join like a terrorist group, it would be a problem, but I'm not going to join a terrorist group.
To the IRA yet?
No, I'm not in the IRA or the UVF or the EDA or any of those. No.
How about the UTI?
UTI? No. Yeah. Not presently, no. UTI what?
Jimmy contracted one of those.
Jimmy probably contracted a few things. Yeah.
It's a BFD.
Have you met any of McNasty's ancestors in Ireland?
I see leprechauns all the time.
Okay.
All the time.
You know, McNasty gets very hostile if you refer to him as Irish. He makes it very clear that he is Scottish. So
that's right.
I did one of those ancestry things. I was convinced there was no way there was any Irish. Of course, they infiltrate everybody. Everybody's Irish.
For our Irish episode, here's
that.
Oh, very good. Shamrocks and four leaves too.
Oh,
awesome. Lucky.
Top of the
lucky.
Morning to you.
Frito O'Grady has brought the four leaf clovers.
Is it true that the McDonald's in Ireland have shamrock shakes year round?
We don't have them at all.
Wait, McDonald's or the shamrock shake?
Are you in real
life? We don't have the shamrock shake and we don't have it for St. Patrick's Day either.
It's offensive.
Is it true that the faucets there emit Guinness as opposed to water?
Yes. Okay. If you go into a pub and somebody buys you a Guinness and you don't drink it, it's offensive and they'll kill you.
Wow.
Right
there.
Okay.
You have to drink it. I hate Guinness. I hate it. It is like a big lumpy shake of a beer is what it is.
It's a meal replacement.
It's a beer you can chew.
It's a beer that drinks like a meal. That's right. Yum, yum.
Tell us about the therapy that you do.
Well, I do applied behavioral analysis and it's not as impressive as you might think. Basically, it's just a therapy where you would take like a specific thing. Like if you wanted your child to use a spoon, you would go through a series of one-to-one training with them and you would say, use a spoon for the yogurt. And you would write down what they did when you asked them to do that. If he did it consecutively 10 times, he used the spoon to eat the yogurt, then you would say that he mastered it. It's kind of a repetitive therapy to teach them how to do skills. When I came over here, they were looking for ABA therapists. And so I pick it up and I do that for a living.
What I don't understand is why would anyone trust a Swedish pop group to treat their autistic family members?
No, it's ABA, not ABBA.
Oh, well, that explains it.
I went to a cover band of them once, and they were called the Bjorn Identity.
Tell us a little bit about your autism advocacy and maybe how others can do the same.
It's important that we include and have an inclusive society for people on the spectrum and that we're a little more understanding. And I think at this point, if you don't know about autism, I don't know where the heck you've been. You know what I mean? Because I think all of us know somebody or have somebody in our family or we know somebody or we, you know, certainly it's happening. But the problem with that is also that there isn't a lot of understanding of certain situations and sensory issues and things like that. And I think we need to kind of educate ourselves and we need to educate teachers for sure.
People need to be more accepting, Jimmy.
What did I do?
You non-accepting bastard.
Is it you, Jimmy? Is it you that we're after? Holy shit. Before I had a child with autism, I didn't know a lot about it. And I mean, certainly I took a lot more of an interest in it because it was happening to my child. We definitely have to make sure that the schools are a little more aware of it. And also we have to make sure that the police force is more aware of it. And they tell parents, like, when you move to a town, you need to go directly to the police department and let them know who your child is, what their issues are. As you know, in the news, and I'm sure you've seen it, there's so many instances where things happen where these kids don't respond to them or, you know, terrible things can happen to them.
When you went to the police station, did you tell them about your issues too?
Yeah.
Okay, that's very responsible of you.
Yeah, I ended up dating one of them, so yeah.
Oh, even better.
So of the following movies, why is the Crater Lake Monster your favorite? And that would be Mandy, Things, and the Crater Lake Monster.
Neither one of these are my favorite. I feel like Mandy is one of those movies like The Sixth Sense. Once you've seen it, you never need to see it again. Not even a month had gone by. We were again watching Mandy.
Objected to.
And also, I was so confused because during the thing, and I guess it's like chapters of a book or something, but it kept coming up with like different names. And I thought, this is a little late in the game for them to be announcing the name of the movie. And then you kept saying, it's Mandy. That's where the confusion came from.
What did you think of the Crater Lake Monster? I thought that people were quite engaged, far beyond what I anticipated when we rolled that thing. I thought people were going to be moaning and groaning. And then by the end, people were like hooting and hollering about that fucking movie.
Are you suggesting that shit show you played last night on
yes.
on the watch party?
Well, we did a Sunday night and we kept, you know, like 10 people engaged with that movie. Normally Sunday night is like me and one other person.
I unfortunately fell asleep, so I will never know what happened.
Well, we'll give you the opportunity to find out when we re-air the Crater Lake Monster.
Please
following Mandy.
No. Let's never re-air that.
Living in Ireland, can you finally put to bed for everyone who I know wonders it? How scientifically accurate are the Leprechaun movies?
They are 100% accurate.
See, Jimmy, I told you.
I said that. No, I said that, Joe. You said they weren't.
That's not true.
Especially the space one.
They're all accurate. And the horror ones, especially accurate.
Have you ever been to Dingle, Ireland?
Yes, I have. I've been to all of Ireland because my sister and I did a tour around the entirety of Ireland. The weirdest by far were the little counties surrounding Cork. Those people are straight up nuts. They usually will just speak Gaelic. They will not speak English to you, even though they
I was
English.
There. That was weird. They did not want to communicate, especially with Americans.
So now, Gino, you played with the Roids, but were you ever in a band with He Who Should Not Be Named?
I was never in a band with him.
Yeah. Most importantly, have you heard of Gino's band, Diamonds on the Rough?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I hear they're going to do a tribute tonight. Yeah. they're going to get back together. Well, when Gino was in it, to be fair, he brought his own piece of lino so that he could break dance during the chorus parts. Yeah, he was really good at it. I mean, you know, you're still pulling those stuff, aren't you, out there?
Yes.
He's our chief breakdancer.
Do you remember that? In high school, people actually bring in pieces of cardboard and just throwing down.
You know, I was probably a couple years before that.
When you look at photos and stuff back in the day, there's like girls wearing those matching little beach frocky things and like they're all brightly colored and boys walking around in pink shorts and stuff and you're going,
oh, yeah. The last year I was there, the hairstyle that was popular was like it was a rat tail thing that guys had, and that
rat
was
rat tails, and then like the white streaks.
Sizzler still has a rat tail. What are you talking about?
Joe just got rid of his rat tail last year.
Yep. Yeah,
oh wow, with the rest of my hair.
You ready to attempt this quiz?
Got second? The answers right Joe's here. Right here. Got the answers right here.
Oh.
Because, I mean, you did say I don't know how to use Google. So that's just want to let you know that I do, in fact, know how to use Google.
It's amazing to me because you'll wait on somebody to answer stuff for you for so long, but then you could have just jumped on Google.
Because I don't want to leave. I mean, there's so much brilliant programming happening.
Show us the calculator you come to the watch party.
This is the calculator that I use. Yeah.
Earn the title of Queen of the Watch Party. There's not a single chance I will be ever moving back to Florida.
I'm going this summer. I'm going. I'm going to be there for a month.
You'll be running. You'll be like, get me out of here.
Oh, I always am. By the time it's time to go, I'm like, oh. The last time I was there, my daughter was quite young. I had stopped into a corner store to get something, and this guy just turned around, looked at me, and went, how much for a blowjob?
Oh.
Right in front of my daughter. South Florida, man.
And then we were at the... Well, how much do you charge?
If you were on My Fans Only, you'd know, wouldn't you, Joe?
And I wanted to compare it to Jimmy's mom's rates.
Man!
We like Ben's mom now.
Ben's mom's gorgeous.
His mom is hotter than my mom. No.
Hashtag Jimmy's mom was a prime mover on the internet.
It wasn't the watch party last night. Too bad Jimmy wasn't there.
Ben's mom, she's like movie star pretty. She is gorgeous. I have not ever seen Jimmy's mom. I've only heard of Jimmy's mom.
Let's get off my mom.
I agree. Everybody has a crush on Ben's mom if you're out there, Ben.
I have a crush on Ben's mom. I don't even like girls. She's gorgeous. Yes.
We're going to have to write a song about Ben's mom. I will read a couple lines from the song. You tell me the next line, name of the band, name of the song. There's two bits of good news this week. All of the songs are based off of the era of music when we went to school. And the other epic support option that you have is you have lifelines in the form of Handsome Jimmy and Cruddy Joe. You know how this works? You just reach out. If you don't know the answer, they can help you with it. If you get all six of them correct, we have our seventh. You would then be in a tie with Ben for the best all time, and then we'd have to have a runoff later for all time.
I don't think there's any risk of that happening, so
I don't know. Everybody says the same exact thing. They're like, there's no chance I can compete, and then they're like, bang, bang, bang. Next thing you know, they've got five in a row, they got six in a row.
I'll let you in on a secret. When I guess them right, it's because Vinny's given me the answer. Yeah. I should message him.
He's at Stallions
in a furry suit, yes.
Let's swerve back to the music lyrics. Are you ready to give the first one a shot?
Sure.
I'll read the lyrics. You tell me the following line, name of the band, name of the song. First one is, whatever happened to all this season's losers of the year? Every time I got to thinking where they disappear. When I woke up, mom and dad are rolling on the couch, rolling numbers, rock and rolling. What is the next line? What is the name of the band and the name of the song? And don't forget your lifelines.
Joe, do you know?
How many times have you seen this show?
Gino, I want you to sing it. Sing it.
Then I woke up. Mom and dad are rolling on the couch. Rolling numbers, rocking, rolling. What's the next line? Name of the band, name of the song.
Jimmy, do you know?
Of course I know.
All right, Jimmy, tell me what it is.
I don't know.
Come on, Jimmy. Come on.
Yes, that's Cheap Trick.
That's correct.
Maggie's Records Out.
That is 100% correct.
Is that the Mommy's All Right? Daddy's All Right.
It sure is. It's Surrender.
I just don't think you sang it in the way that it was supposed to be.
I sang it exactly like Robin Zander did. Jimmy knew immediately. Joe even knew that one.
No, I didn't.
You didn't know that, Joe?
Nope, I don't like Cheap Trick.
What the fuck's the matter with you, man?
I gotta go.
All I know now is that you're one of one.
I like Cheap Trick. I'm just saying it's not something I would have just came, you know.
Well, let's try the second one and keep that phone in your hand. Keep your eyeballs out of it. Here we go. Okay. See me right out of the sunset on your color TV screen, out for all that I can get, if you know what I mean. Women to the left of me and women to the right ain't got no gun, ain't got no knife. Name of the band, name of the song, and what's the next line? I'll give you the opportunity to confer with your lifelines. Would you like to reach out to your lifelines?
I would. Is it Jimmy? Is it Jimmy? It's Jimmy.
Oh, what? I'm sorry.
Do you know this one, Jimmy?
I think I do.
What is it?
AC/DC, right?
Correct.
TNT or something. He's Dynamite something.
You sing it in the same monotone for every song. That's why.
Do I have to sing another one?
You gotta sing it in the key.
I don't know the words.
Come on, in the key.
She told me to come, but I was already there.
Vomit. Where's the vomit emoji? See me right out of the sunset on your color TV screen, out for all that I can get, if you know what I mean. Women to the left of me and women to the right. Ain't got no gun, ain't got no knife.
Don't you start no
fight. Oh, Joe got it for you. Don't start no fight.
Good collab.
That was...
We're on our way here. All right, let's move on to number three before shit totally melts down here. Another one from the same era. Just as easy as the other one. You're two of two somehow. Let's do this. Put his ear to the wall and like a distant scream, he heard one guitar. It just blew him away. He saw stars in his eye and the very next day. What's the next line? Name of the band, name of the song.
Jukebox Hero.
Thank you. Jukebox Hero. Yes.
What's the next line?
Well, sing it for me and I'll tell you.
Sing it.
Put his ear to the wall and like a distant scream, he heard one guitar. It just blew him away. He saw stars in his eye and the very next day.
Bought himself a six string at a secondhand store.
That's correct. And between the three of you, you got Foreigner and Jukebox Hero, so you're now three of three. See how that happened?
I was never a fan of Foreigner.
Doesn't matter. I'm not a fan of them either. We aced the entire music section here. Now we're on to the movie quote section.
I'm always going to be queen of the watch party.
This part is movie quotes. I'll read the quote. Just tell me who said it and what the movie is. And this is not relegated to that same era. The first one is, did I ever tell you that this here jacket represents a symbol of my individuality and my belief in personal freedom? She's not looking at the screen. She's totally.
I'm not even looking at, look, my hands are free. I've not touched.
I'm talking about a Zoom screen where somebody's trying to get your attention.
And Joe knows it. All right, Joe, go.
Nicholas
go,
Cage
Joe.
And Wild at Heart.
It absolutely is Nicholas Cage and Wild at Heart.
How did I not know that? Oh my God.
You were too busy looking for excuses or at your phone to realize you already knew the answer.
You know, it's not a conversation with Gene until he tells me how everything I'm doing is not right. Thank you, Gene. Thank
well,
you.
Magically, you are four of four. Okay, here's another easy one. It's a short quote. Fuck a doodle doo. Who says that? What's the movie?
I say that all the time. Fuck a doodle doo.
I'll give you a hint. This was somewhat in the realm of the kind of horror movies that you like, in an area that is not too far from where you are. What movie is Fuck a doodle doo from?
Obviously, that's Shaun of the Dead. I can't think of that guy's name.
Sean.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
You backhandedly got 505 because you were the queen of the watch party.
I am.
But now I am worried about this final one because this is the most difficult one. It's why I saved it to the last. Maybe one of these two can help you out. The quote is, can't you see it? Them sirens did this to him. They loved him up and turned him into a horny toad.
Oh, brother, where art thou?
Yes. Who's the character?
God, though, I do know.
It was the guy who wasn't John Turturro or George Clooney.
Right.
Dude, his name was Delmar.
Delmar. I have that soundtrack somewhere. That was a brilliant soundtrack.
Well, you jumped right in there and got the answer for that. So somehow, here you are at six of six.
Somehow. Hello.
Yep.
Maybe it's
a cast, obviously.
This is where it all falls apart if you don't know the answer. Now, I didn't give this question to Ben because we already had another question set aside for him. But this is one we have asked other people in the past and they did not know. So you got to dig deep and tell us what the answer to this one is. What was the job held by Boomhauer on King of the Hill? What was Boomhauer's job?
Boomhauer is the one who speaks real fast.
Yep, that's Boomhauer. What that's job Boomhauer. Did he hold? What was his job?
Boomhauer.
Do you guys know?
Okay, Joe. I picked Joe.
Texas Ranger.
Winslow agrees with you. He is a Texas Ranger.
Wow.
Look at that. All of a sudden, Ben has a rival. Lisa is tied for the all-time champion.
Yeah, boy. Woo.
Are you ready to participate in Nad Libs?
I am always ready to participate. Let's go.
I'll ask you for a couple word types. You fill it in, then we'll read you back the story that Joe has written for you.
I've never seen this before, so this is exciting.
I need a synonym for whining.
Gurning. In Northern Ireland, they say that gurney child or she's gurning.
How do I spell that?
G-U-R-N-I-N-G.
A place to see movies.
Drive-in.
Favorite booze.
Booze?
Booze, not booze.
I was going to say my own, because they're Costa Rican rum.
Something you wear to bed.
Nothing. A t-shirt.
A synonym for dangerous.
Perilous. Perilous, perilous, perilous. P-E-R-I-L-I-O-U-S.
A synonym for sexual.
Sensuous. S-E-N.
Exactly.
Yeah, thank you.
Something you wear to the prom.
Me? I would wear a tiara. Because I would have been a princess and now I'm the queen.
Something you carry money in.
Wallet.
Synonym for shocked.
Stunned. S-T-U-N-N-E-D.
A watch party regular.
Sizzler. Sizzle daddy.
Sizzler.
Oh, Bo's going to be upset. Bo okay. Didn't.
A famous monster mask. That would be a mask of a famous monster. Yes.
Frankenstein.
Easy enough, and I know how to spell that. Your favorite number.
22.
A facial feature.
Mouth. M-O-U-T-H.
a synonym for explode.
Ejaculate.
Wow.
Ooh. She's that kind of girl. She's that kind of girl. Oh,
all right. This is going places.
Oh, I'm sure it's going places.
Your least favorite insect.
Cockroach.
Synonym for dirty.
Filthy.
A synonym for poop. That means I've already wrote this story, but I'm going to give you some slight options here.
Crap.
C-R-A-P.
If Jimmy's mom's not in it, is it really the story?
Is my mom in it, Joe?
Jimmy's mom is always in it.
So. I hope Jimmy's mom's in it because I'm going to be very disappointed if she isn't. You shouldn't put it in your anus during these.
I could get through these.
I can't hear him. Gino, it's going to have to be you.
All right, we're going to read this.
All right.
The name of this story is Lisa Finally Sees COVID Zombies. One sultry evening, after gurning incessantly about wanting to watch COVID Zombies, Lisa got a mysterious message on Facebook from a user named MandyMovie69. The stranger asked if Lisa really wanted to see COVID Zombies that bad. Lisa replied emphatically that she did. The stranger then sent Lisa directions to a secret drive-in. You see where this is going. The movie would be free, but she'd have to come alone. After downing another bottle of Costa Rican rum, Lisa got dressed in her favorite t-shirt.
Oh!
Following the directions, Lisa soon found herself in the perilous part of town. On the street corner, handsome Jimmy's mom solicited various tourists for the wide variety of sensuous services she offered.
Ooh, that was one of them.
Jimmy's mom looked very provocative in her outfit, which was a tiara, but strategically modified to emphasize her assets. Intrigued by a possible business proposal, Lisa checked her wallet. Sadly,
does she have competitive prices?
This is like the story you told us about being in Florida. Sadly, she didn't have enough money to party. Dejected, Lisa continued on her way to the theater. Upon arrival, Lisa was stunned to find Sizzler standing outside. Lisa approached this person and was promptly handed a Frankenstein mask.
Ooh.
Once inside, Lisa was instructed to put on the mask. As the film started, Lisa kept hollering out, "What movie is this?"
I would, too. I would.
Fortunately,
Sizzler
there were no...
Sizzler would be the only one to watch it with me. Go on.
Fortunately, there were no other patrons in the theater to hear her ranting. This is going to get bad. Once COVID Zombies started, it only took Lisa 22 minutes to realize how stupid it is. Upon that realization, Lisa's temples began to throb and it felt like her mouth might pop off her head. Just as Lisa...
Justice Lisa, what did I do, Gino?
Justice Lisa thought her skull might ejaculate in her eyes, instead popped out of her sockets.
Ooh.
Suddenly, worms and cockroaches came spilling out of her eye sockets and mouth. As Lisa slowly died, she slumped over in her seat and fell onto the filthy theater floor. As Lisa faded into oblivion amongst the discarded candy wrappers, rotten popcorn, and used condoms, she looked up at the screen and smiled, knowing she had finally seen the piece of crap known as COVID zombies. Later, when Hugh Jackman came to the theater, he found Lisa's dead body and immediately checked her pockets for valuables. When he didn't find anything, Jackman settled on simply teabagging her corpse. Afterwards, Jackman then went to the lobby to perform his nightly ritual of shitting in the popcorn warmers. The end.
Joe,
I don't know what.
Shame on you.
I promise you, I did not write that.
Yeah,
that I chose the right thing though, because Sizzler would be the only person who would watch Corona Zombies with me, and I realized it was stupid the second I saw it. That's why I want to watch it.
I think you got in there. Sizzler would have you watching the what's the one with the clown that he loves so much?
Oh no, Art, no.
I forgot about that. I would put Art in there somewhere.
What were you saying about your mother, Jimmy? What was that?
What was the point of having her in there? She didn't. There was nothing in the story.
Because she offered sensuous services.
I didn't have enough money, though.
It doesn't propel the narrative at all.
Yeah, I just wanted to emphasize her sluttery. Gino had the best joke last night, Jimmy. I'll share it with you. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Emerson.
Emerson who?
Emerson, nice titties on Jimmy's mom.
Oh my God, they were tearing into you last night, Jimmy.
You bastards.
Jimmy, do we have a credit cuisine this week?
We do. Would you like to take the
Let's go to that. Let's
take a clip.
Can we go to the clip?
Night, night. Gonna shave them really nice. Run them through the freaking red thing. Rinse them off and treat them right. Gonna turn them so dumb. In some oil, maybe layer with some funky cheese. Oh, everybody loves them when it's fucking steak. Yeah. God damn, stack them taters. Good Lord. Potato stacking time. Curry chops, melted shit, and some buttered donuts. Mushrooms, right? You want that steak on fire? Take the salad too. Take the taters out. Put them on a plate. You got to get your steak and oil and some veggies. Kids like that too. Oh, it's all good when you got them veggies and salad. Ooh, and taters too. And don't forget the mushrooms and the steak night.
What's Vinny got going this week? Come on, Vinny.
Let's go to the clip. You've come to the clip. Okay, well, anyway, hi, folks. For tonight, instead of doing just my entry for my top 500 films, here's a film I definitely want to recommend most highly. There's a lot of great Vincent Price films, and he's my favorite actor. But I've got to say, and a lot of other people say this too, that his best performance has got to be from Theater of Blood. from the early 70s. He did a lot of these revenge films in the 70s, the Fives movies, Madhouse, and then Theater of Blood, definitely his best performance. It's number 27 on my top 500 list. Basically, you get to see Vincent Price do amazing acting. He's an actor who's pissed off at these critics that have trashed his Shakespeare performances, and he dispatches them one by one using different murders and deaths from Shakespeare performances. And you get to see him do a lot of Shakespeare, and you get to see him do a lot of characters to lure each of these critics away from cops so he can kill them. And each murder is crazy and insane and very clever. The very last one is the best. For those that have seen it, you know what I'm talking about. And if you haven't, definitely watch this movie. Rent it. You know what? Forget it. Buy this movie. You need it for your collection. Theater of Blood. And he's joined by a great supporting cast of great British actors. There's lots of fun. There's lots of murder. It's clever. It's funny. It's such fantastic, ghoulish fun. So I highly recommend this film. It's a movie to treasure. And it definitely is Vincent Price's best performance. So number 27 on my list, Theater of Blood.
Hey McNasty, what actors would play the Cruds in the Creeping Cruds movie?
Bo would be played by Willem Dafoe. Gene would be played by John Malkovich. Jimmy would be played by Hugh Jackman, and I would be played by Scooter from The Muppets.
Are we going to have a bow reading this week?
Oh, sorry. Let's go to the clip.
Gregory turned to his sister. Their eyes met.
I am sorry, she whispered.
The water in front of the pier exploded. Gregory screamed and Alexa fell backwards onto the dock. Her eyes widened as the behemoth rose from the depths, causing a residual wave to crash against the pier, flattening Gregory in his wagon and knocking Alexa over the side into the ocean. She dropped several feet, the salt water invading her nostrils and eyes. The water was hot, but did not burn. She pushed her hair away and was met with darkness and sand. Lightning flashed above, drawing her attention back to the pier. She swam toward the surface when something bright flashed below. Alexa was forced to look down. The ocean bottom appeared to be cracking, green light and smoke spewing from the ensuing fissures. Something moved in the darkness. Alexa looked up. The silt and debris parted. The green light revealed something large and snake-like that stretched into the darkness beyond. The behemoth's body. In the distance, she saw dozens of iridescent green eyes swimming towards her, encircling the mammoth serpentine body as they moved closer. Alexa could just make out their long, white faces, screaming mouths and three-fingered hands reaching. She grabbed the first rung of the ladder and pulled herself out of the sea.
At the very end of the Livin Cruddy episode, everybody went off to look at it and missed the little ending story there with Joe and Zelda.
That was really nice. That's touching.
Yeah, that part where she picks it up and it was my intro to the show.
Her voice was
hilarious too. Joe.
You know whose voice that was, right?
It was you doing it, wasn't it?
Maybe. Maybe it was Zelda.
Oh.
Hello, Joe. Get the phone. All right, Lisa, do you have anything that you would like to promote?
Oh, peace, love, and happiness. Oh, and Corona Zombies. I'd like to see some Corona Zombies.
Well, that's all we got for tonight, weirdos. I want to thank my pals, the House of Pain gang. We have Handsome Jimmy Hansen and the Full Shillelagh, Gino Roy Coffinberry. And I'd also like to thank our awesome guest, Ms. Lisa Allan Monaghan. And finally, I want to thank Jimmy's mom for services rendered.
Too expensive. You can't afford it. I am the queen of the watch party. I'm always going to be queen of the watch party. How much for a blowjob?
kill you and your family and everyone associated with you.